So good afternoon, everyone. My name is Michael Taylor, the director of the Hood Museum of Art at Dartmouth College, and it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to our third artist panel in conjunction with the Artist in Residence show. On January 28th, just to recap, we had Louise Fishman, Linda Matalin, and John Newman discussing their experiences as visiting artists at Dartmouth. Then on April 24th, Shubhanka Banerjee, Daniel Heyman, and Sana Musasama addressed the theme of art and activism. And our third and final panel discussion this afternoon takes as its theme art and a sense of place. And because we're kind of twisted tricksters, Jerry and I thought, well, we don't want to talk about landscape. We want to actually get three artists who live in, I'll say where they live. So Varujan Boghosian lives in Hanover, New Hampshire, James McGarrell in Newbury, Vermont, and Rebecca Purdum in Ripton, Vermont. We wanted to have them talk about their work, their ideas, their artistic process, and in conjunction with that, think about what it has been like to live in this area and what possible impact that's had on their work. Today's panel will be followed by a reception in the Kim Gallery, and you're all invited to that. And I should point out that it is actually Varujan's 88th birthday today. So we have a special surprise for him upstairs at 6. That's about all I'm going to say. I think we've learned something really great about these artist panels, is that you don't want to hear me rambling on about what honors these people have won, what degrees they've been awarded. They've all been awarded so many, it would take half an hour. Instead, I think you really want to hear about them and their work. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over in order to Varujan. And here you see the three artists' work. And I thought I'd just show you how each artist's work has been used for teaching in this show. The way in which especially the studio art faculty have used this exhibition has just been incredible. So you've just seen Colleen and Brenda, and I think Brenda again talking about their work. So without further ado, here's Varujan Boghosian.
Is this the microphone?
No, that's the microphone.
Oh. Hi, can you hear it back there? Last row. I came here in 1968 as artist in residence in the summer, and I had my show in Jaffe Freedy. I'd just like to say a little about the artist in residence program. I'm sure that many of you know about the program and the details. Some of you don't. We're very unique here at Dartmouth in having this program where we bring in a distinguished artist for a term. Normally we have three during the course of a year, or that's what we did have. I've retired now a number of years, so I'm not quite certain about the schedule. But every 10 weeks we would bring in an outstanding artist, and we have continued to do so. What is unique about the program is there is a stipend. When I first came, I think it was $3,000 for the 10-week period. I'm sure it's more than that now, probably five or even. How much? How much is it? The artist has a one-person show, usually a catalog. They do not have to teach. All they have to do is work in their studio or take naps or whatever. But for 10 weeks, they have an idyllic life. Some of them do get involved, and I think most of them, with students. I think their studio is open, and maybe some of them even might teach something. I don't know what the schedule is now. However, I would just like to give you a couple of little anecdotes. We had Walker Evans here, who was, as you know, one of our great, great artists, unbelievable photographer. How we conned him in, I think, was the fact that he was really quite penniless at the time. So to get this offer, he was very eager. He came up here. He was really a very funny, impish type of person who carried with him a pair of pliers and a wrench and a screwdriver whenever he saw a beautiful sign outside, like a stop sign with bullet holes in it. He would say, "Stop the car." He would get out. I think he even had a little hacksaw. And he would actually take the sign. One day I was with him on Main Street, and there was a barber whose name was Trot, where Eastman's drugstore used to be. He was upstairs. He was sort of a self-proclaimed minister. If you went in there, you got an hour lecture on Revelations or Genesis or what have you. Anyway, down below in the doorway, he had the most beautiful sign. It was made of reflectors and enamel work, and it said Trot, T-R-O-T-T. It was 4 o'clock in the afternoon. I was with him. He saw the sign. "I've got to have that sign." He reached in his pocket. He took out his screwdriver and pliers, and he started to unscrew the sign. I said, "Walker, we're going to be arrested." "I don't care. I've got to have that sign." He got the sign. Years later, after he left, he was very ill after a few weeks, and he had major surgery at the Hitchcock, and he left town with the sign. Years later, in a monogram on him, there on a page was his apartment in New Haven. On the wall was the sign, "Trot." The Museum of Modern Art actually had a postcard made of it. I have one, but I can't find it. It's somewhere. Anyway, he was absolutely penniless, one of the great artists. And I think the service we did, you know, in having him up here was a wonderful gesture. The other was Fritz Scholder, who came here. He was the opposite of Walker. He was very successful, and he was having shows in Europe, everywhere. The phone was always ringing. We'd have coffee in the coffee shop in the Hop, and the phone would ring. He'd say, I have to go in the studio. He'd come back. He'd say, "Oh, that was a call from Germany." And he'd say, "I just wish life would stop right at this moment." Anyway, those were two of the stories. I pass it on to my colleague, Ms. Purdum.
But you didn't talk about your own work.
Well.
You haven't run your slides.
Are they there?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's hard to see, you know. I work with found objects, as some of you know. And I work in a slightly, not a very large format, although I have done a few large pieces. Basically, they're small scale. A lot of them have to do with the material. The material at times dictates the piece. On the right, I think, is a piece called Celebration, which is a little child's rattle, metal rattle. In the background is furniture that people who would put together a broadside or a newspaper, they lock the type in with lead furniture. And I found a place in Rome, a secondhand supply place. Every time I went, I would get a box of these. They come in different geometric sizes and weigh a ton. And I've used those. I use the backs of frames, the backs of paintings serve as my canvas. I have used, where are we?
Do you want to go forward?
Keep going, huh?
Oh, I love art history and the horseshoe and the American colors are an homage to Pitot, the great Tromp painter who lived in Philadelphia along with Harnett. And he has a beautiful painting of a horseshoe, and I've used that theme a number of times. Next.
American Bouquet.
Oh, this is called American Bouquet. It's a bouquet of flowers. However, the flowers are whiskey swivel sticks. And I think it's, it says Johnny Walker on it. And I figured it's American bouquet, the bouquet of whiskey. Get the pun? Next. I deal a lot with the Orpheus myth. Somehow or other, I had a wonderful teacher in high school who introduced me to the myth of Orpheus. This piece is chipboard cut in geometric sizes, covered with sculpt metal, which is liquid lead. When it hardens, burnished with steel wool to a polish. Down below is a little boat carrying Charon, the boatman of the Styx, and Orpheus. And they were two little World War I lead soldiers. I sanded down the uniforms so they become anonymous. They're both blowing trumpets. And the boat that they're on was a stick I found on the beach where someone had mixed green paint, and you can see the green in the front. And I remember my Latin teacher telling me that Charon was young, old, and green. Next. This is a hat block form, and it is studded with nails. It is in a box that was originally a salt box for cows. They would put salt in it, and the cow would lick the salt. So you can see the worn edges very beautifully brought down. I found four of them in a junk shop. They were $10 for the four. That was in 1962, maybe. And each one has a hat block form, and the nails are studded in different configurations in each piece. Are we done?
No.
Oh. Well, I like the idea of school, and this is a child's slate in the days when children had slates that they would bring to school. This is an elaborate one because it has decorations on the outside, usually the alphabet, so that the child could copy the letters. And in each corner, I've inserted a very thin metal butterfly, then the string with the bead in the middle. Are we done? Oh, well, pipes, yeah. Well, I suppose this is an homage to Joseph Cornell. I walked the beaches in Provincetown. The fishermen over the years, and I mean a number of hundred years, would be smoking clay pipes, and when they would break, they would knock off a piece. Over the years, when you walk at low tide, and if your eyes are keen, you will find these fragments. And I think I've amassed Paul Bowen, who teaches here occasionally, is another great scavenger on the beaches. I started out, I had more clay pipe fragments than he did. However, he lived there year round. I could only walk the beaches in the summer 2 or 3 months. He's amassed thousands and thousands. And you know what he did? He threw them back in the ocean, which I think is a very nice thing to do. I have not done that.
Recess.
Recess is another one. That's based on Winslow Homer's painting of the school marm with the school bell, that wonderful painting. So these themes are translated, in one form or another into different objects.
That's it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
My residency was in 1993,
And in 1992, I was still living in St. Louis, where I had been teaching at Washington University, and I conceived of doing a suite of paintings, very large canvases, more than 6 feet high, on the subject of 10 different, and it became 11, 20th century artists that I admired in many media when they were young, confronting their older self. That was my exhibition when I was artist in residence here. I'm going to, let's see. The first one was Charles Chaplin. I titled them all The Something or Another. This was the actor, young and old, Charles Chaplin. I never do preparatory drawings for my paintings. I never paint from photographs, except in this case, because of the need for likenesses, I did use photographs as an aid. But I was just playing with the idea of doing paintings which would not be biographically or historically factual, but playing with the spirit of these different artists, which I hope to reflect in the paintings. Ezra Pound, Charles Chaplin painting, by the way, is in the Rose Art Museum at Brandeis University. This is Ezra Pound when he was young and when he was old. Ezra Pound was born in Idaho and he died in Venice. And the idea of moving from the place of his birth to places in the world which could not be more unlike each other, I thought. And that was one of the themes that I was playing with in the making of this painting. I often used images of animals, not because they were particularly appropriate or in any kind of biographical way, but because I thought that they would kind of reflect the spirit of the artist that I was exploring. The composer, young and old, Igor Stravinsky. In this case, a horse. There's something about the muscularity and energy of a horse which seemed to me to be an appropriate image to play with in the making of this piece. The novelist, young and old, Vladimir Nabokov, who seems to be sitting at a chessboard playing chess with his younger self, who is brandishing in his face a hand puppet of a butterfly. My conception of the landscape from which he sprang and then the bleeding into that of an interior, a kind of interior that in my imagination would have been occupied by him. The songwriter, young and old, Cole Porter, who was a Hoosier, as I am. I was born in Indiana. The poet, young and old, Elizabeth Bishop. The director, young and old, Orson Welles. The young Orson Welles is filming the older Orson Welles in front of what seems to be a screen with theatrical face masks on it. On the lower right-hand side, my wife and I once had lunch at a restaurant in Paris called La Méditerranée, and we saw Orson Welles in there. And in my memory, he was eating lobsters. I don't know if he was or not, but my game, in my imagistic game in making this painting, was to have the live lobsters crawling out of a bucket of ice water onto some kind of step stool, and then across the floor, climbing up onto the table for the older Orson Welles delectation. this was the only painting. It's the painter, young and old, Henri Matisse. It was not in my exhibition here. It was done after the exhibition. And the climactic painting of the whole suite, this is two canvases of the same size as the others, and it's in the exhibition upstairs. It's the grand artifactor, young and old. I'm going to show you now, I have photographs of the stages of the painting from the beginning to the end. I always begin my paintings with transparent washes of transparent oil color. And I work all over the painting at that stage. I'm not so much thinking about subject matter that at this stage, although I have it in mind, I'm thinking much more about structure, how I'm going to organize the rhythms, the horizontals, the verticals, the diagonals, the ellipses, and I'm making a seat for the color of the succeeding layers of the paint, because paintings for me are more about color on color than they are color on white. And so that transparent palette, which is still being used in the all over conception and development of the painting at this stage, are deriving their luminosity from the white of the canvas striking through the transparency, which is a different kind of light, painting light, than opaque paints using white pigments, which happens in the development of the painting after that. So at this stage, I'm beginning now, having established those kinds of structural ideas and color seeding, I'm beginning to work in zones. And I work at this stage with a full palette, including opaque pigments and white. And I develop much more highly zone by zone, working through the composition. Lower right-hand corner, obviously. I was working around the edges, then I moved from that to the left-hand side and then up into the corner and across the top of the painting. Then down on the right-hand side. My paintings tell me, I learn from my paintings where I want to go next. So the paintings are improvised in a way that for me, development of what they're going to be grows out of what they were in the earlier stage. And this is I was going to read something that I had written about the meaning of Joyce to me and the way that kind of subject can feed the painting. But it's on Michael's label. There's a quotation of it on Michael's label on the painting upstairs. So
great. Thank you, Jim. Mm-hmm. Fascinating to see the stage of that painting, and when you go upstairs and look at it, it suddenly will make sense. I think you always do sense that it's all under there. So our third speaker and final speaker is Rebecca Purdum. Rebecca, do you have enough light to read?
I do. I do.
Okay.
I think I can do. If not, I'll fake it. I think. First of all, I must say thank you to you. And to everyone at the Hood for And also to Jerry Otten and all of my dear friends in the studio art department for not only giving me the opportunity to be part of this historic exhibition, but to be here today with Varujan Boghosian and James McGarrell, two colossal artists whose influence is so deep and whose work is so inspiring. To say that it is a privilege for me and an honor is totally inadequate. So thank you. Thank you very much. The paintings that I'm going to show you today, there are eight of them, and except for the painting that's upstairs, they all were done in the last 2 years. And I'm actually not going to talk about them individually, but I'm going to just scroll through them as I talk to you today. And obviously, if you have any questions about a specific painting, I can address them later. The theme is how we've responded to living and working in rural Vermont, and that seems like a pretty straightforward question, but it actually was a very difficult one for me to think about and to talk about today. And actually, I have to start in Idaho, because I was born in Idaho, and I don't remember anything about Idaho. My father was attending the U.S. Navy's nuclear training school there, and he eventually had command of two submarines. But what that meant was during my childhood, we moved a lot. We moved from Idaho to Connecticut, to California, back to Connecticut, to Northern Virginia, and finally to Rhode Island when my father retired. And I was already living in New York City by then. And I continued to move around Manhattan. I had four different addresses and six different studios there. And there were five more addresses and five more studios after I left the city. And I liked moving. I liked going through my things and deciding what I wasn't going to take. I was not as fond of keeping or maintaining or holding on to things as I was of letting go. And I think it was a survival tool when I was a child, being the new kid so many times. But it served me well since, because I think it's a good tool for a painter to have. It's helpful to be able to let go of things in a painting. So until I moved to Vermont in 1994, I really had no basis to build any sense of place on. And I think in some ways that hasn't changed. Even after 20 years, I've been in Ripton now for 15 of those years, because I can always imagine a cardboard box and what will and won't go in it. But the studio is different. When I was here in 2009 and I gave my talk as artist in residence, then I mentioned the constancy of the studio. The paint is always the same no matter where you are, and I've always set the chair and the palette up the same way, and the action and the inaction are the same, and the ghosts you carry around are the same no matter what's outside the door. Well, what's different now is I like what's outside the door. Probably for the first time in my adult life, I like looking out at the chaos of nature, above, below, and in between. And that chaos is purpose, which is perfect and functions perfectly well without me. And that's what I want in my painting, a perfection independent of myself. Independent of myself. And the kind of painting I'm talking about is ultimately about painting. And that means abstraction at its very best is a process of eliminating or letting go of everything that is non-essential to it. It requires patience because I think color
and the other physical characteristics of paint and the act of painting itself are so emotionally full. And they elicit all kinds of feelings, of course, that have nothing to do with the painting. And I think getting rid of these things takes a really long time. It might take a month or years, and I'm actually thinking now that it's going to take me a lifetime. But I think what I'm hopefully ending up with is art, because I think art is ultimately too selfless and perfect. I actually feel that I'm caught between two realities when I go out to paint. There's the perfect reality of a blank canvas, and then of course there's nature outside. And I really feel like I have to start with something, and of course I'm going to choose the painting. I have a story to tell, and this is a true story that I hope will illustrate better what I'm trying to express to you. One morning, some years ago, I was driving on the highway, and it was very early in the morning, so I turned on the radio, and the sound that came out was birdsong, actual birdsong, and I held my breath listening because I didn't want to miss any of it. And I know many of you here will remember Robert J. Lertzema, and for those of you who don't, Mr. Lertzema was the host of a radio show called Morning Pro Musica. And his show always started with a dawn chorus of birds, and it would run for some time, and then the theme music, a piece by Handel maybe, would gradually come up replacing the bird song. But this morning in the car driving along, the bird song, it went on and then it stopped, and then there was a very long silence. Even by Lertzema standards, it was a long silence. And just when I thought that there might be something wrong with the station, his voice came on. And I don't remember exactly what he said, but it was something like he had been listening to the bird song too, and he was waiting for the music to start. And then he realized he was the one who had to start it. And I think this is what it's like living and working in rural Vermont. And in fact, I think this is our job as artists, no matter where we are, that we have to start the music, so to speak, even when we know deep in our hearts that we've already heard it. A visitor to the studio once told me that she thought that my paintings looked just like where I live, but she couldn't say how. And it reminded me of a trip I took once in Switzerland, a train trip up the Engadine Valley. The mountains were very close on both sides of the train, and you couldn't see the sky even if you craned your head hard to one side looking out the window. And it was slightly alarming in that sublime way, you know, the vertical constriction and the light that seemed to infuse everything without having any real source. And I thought, now I understand Alberto Giacometti's work in a way that I couldn't have before, because this was the area, of course, that his family was from, and it was an area that he knew well. And he wasn't obviously painting or sculpting mountains, but there was some osmosis that at work, I think, that probably made him the artist that he was. And maybe that's what's happening with my work at last. I've lived now in Ripton and painted there long enough to not have a choice about its influence. The motion outside, the sounds, and the everydayness. But I think the awareness of that, of this struggle that I have, makes me even more protective of what I hold on to in the studio and what it's like in the studio, and how that informs my work and its stillness and its silence and its singular purpose, which is simply painting. So thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca. That was absolutely beautiful. So Varujan spoke about the outstanding artists who have been a part of the Artist in Residence program, and I think tonight's panel really speaks to that. I think we've probably got lots of questions in the audience, and why don't we throw it open? And if you don't ask one, I will. Who would like to go first? Anyone? All right, well, I'll start off with a question. So one of the things that I was struck by talking with you earlier, Rebecca, was you were saying how when you get in the zone in your painting, you can't even go shopping. You have to just stay in that studio. And it resonated with another thing you said to me, which is you also paint with the blinds down, so you're not seeing outside. And I'm just wondering, for all of the panel, when you are in the creative act, do you feel the same way? Is it a necessity, and you sort of have to give up all the things you need to do in life and just do the work?
Well, I'm sure there are many artists here. I have a lot of people that spend a lot of time in the studio. And I think we're all extremely protective of that time and that space in there. And there is, I really do think that, well, that the kind of abstraction I do is separate from all that other stuff that I do in my life anyway, which I have to do by necessity. And so when I go in and I do pull the blinds and I sit there for a long time, you know, Varujan, you mentioned taking a nap. But I do. I sleep in there, and I think when you wake up in there and you see a painting right away, certainly one that's in progress, you see things that you hadn't seen before. And I think the time aspect is important because I do feel like I want to get rid of those things that are bothering me, that I'm thinking about, in order to feel the painting. I think I'm painting towards some kind of encounter, and I don't think I can have that encounter if I'm thinking too much about that. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And so I do block it all out. I can't block out the sound of the birds and the sounds and things of that nature, but all of that leafy chaos that I mentioned, that if I just go outside and sit in that, you know, because that really is perfect, you know. And I think one has to evaluate what your painting means to you and why you paint. And I think in some respects, for me, it's there is a spirituality connected to it. And when I talked about that encounter, I mean, it's I paint until I feel something else there, and so there's a transparency that I think it's important on my part in order for that to happen.
Do you guys want to take it up on that question, or should we ask another?
Ask Kim.
I sort of like the daily rituals of painting, of a painting day, the idea of going up to my studio. My studio is in the attic space, the third floor space in Newbury, Vermont, of a building which was originally a cross-gabled colonial, but then was transformed to a mansard space in the Victorian era. I have a skylight. I go up, I water my plants, I make the coffee. I decide if I want to listen to music, or I often listen to poets reading their own work as well as music, and sometimes I do not listen to anything at all and turn on the machine. But since I don't paint from external sources, my subject and what tells me what I have next to do, is the painting that I have already done. And so observation of the painting turning on and telling me what moves I need to make next to make the music of the painting once some kind of idea of subject as an excuse to make a painting has been established.
And Varujan, you're often like a squirrel putting away these nuts for the winter. You're finding things and
I wish John Fox would stop bringing me stuff. I have to. I think there certainly is a big difference between painting and making objects. I understand what Rebecca is talking about. It has a great spirituality to it. And her type of search, I really respect, and I think I understand something about it. However, I work differently. I mean, the door's open, anybody can walk in, I'll still keep cutting away, I can talk, and in the end, I've made something, and then I go out and have a cup of coffee. I'm an illustrator in a way, but I think in the good sense of the word. Illustration has a terrible connotation. However, McGarrell's an illustrator. However, when you walk into that house, his dining room, what he has done to those walls and what you enter into is beyond illustration. He is an image maker. I'm an image maker. I think Gustin at one point said he just couldn't continue, you know, making the beautiful paint strokes that he was doing. He had to get back to an image. And you know, he started off with, he was an image maker in the beginning anyway. He did great image work. And then when abstract expression hit the spot, you know, he went into that field. But then he returned to the comic strips. And then after that profound period at the end of his life. I respect and really admire what artists like Rebecca do. But I'm different. And putting together a construction doesn't have the type of turmoil and inward, whatever those words are. It comes very easily to me. And maybe there's an aspect of superficiality to it. But I always say, if the image you make can be different, like it hasn't been done before, I think that's valid. Mm-hmm. So if I do a still life collage or construction, I'm always hoping that for all that I have seen, that it's a little different and fits into that. You know what I mean?
I know what you mean.
Yeah. So we're all different. And I would love to be a painter if I come back again.
No, do what you do.
I would.
Keep doing what you do.
I would like that. Yeah.
Let's see if we've got any questions from the audience.
I just wanted to say, speaking of Gustin, what Varujan said reminded me, I read an interview with him once, and he said something pertinent to this subject. I'm paraphrasing it now, but he said, when you begin a painting, He said, all of your friends are there, the critics are all there, your dealer is there, they're all looking at the painting with you, wondering what you're going to do. And after a while, they begin to go away a little bit. And pretty soon, it's only you and the painting. And then he says, pretty soon after that, you go away.
That's a great thing. Yes.
He said, it's a long process for a few moments of innocence. Yeah.
That's a great question.
What was
it? So thinking yep. less about physically being fixed in one place, but what happens to your work if you're moving? Like, for example, did your work change when you came here and you were in a different studio?
Mm-hmm.
Anyone?
I don't think that mine did. I think that my painting grows so much out of what I have established for myself as a kind of pattern that, of course, I want to keep my eyes open and as a breather of air and a consumer of cheese and a mover through the village that I live in. I'm sure it operates on the way that I think, but I'm not sure how it does or if I have any control of that.
Was your question more, was it about a sense of being isolated, or were you trying to make a distinction between city and country, or
I don't really know. I'm just trying to broaden this idea of place, and maybe I just think that when you're in a place like this, surrounded by artists in the art galleries, it's easier to sort of find your place relative to that whole world.
Yeah.
But I'm wondering if there even is a difference, like what the process, when, particularly when you're more isolated, but just in general, what do you think as an artist's sense of place in terms of a broader sense of it than just a physical location? Maybe a temporal location, or maybe a location in relation to other artists. But I'm just kind of wondering if that makes sense, if you could kind of expand a little on more than just a physical setting, but sort of what that means to you as an artist.
Right. I lived in New York City for 11 years before I left. I think that was very crucial part of my development as an artist, in being in the city and being surrounded by artists all the time. And it was very easy, in a sense, that when things were going bad in the studio, you could go out and you could see other people or other artists, and they would either be doing better than you, it'd make you feel good, or they'd be doing worse. And that would make you feel good, I think your whole when you're making art, it's a process too of figuring out what's important to you, right? And I knew that after 11 years that being in that kind of environment where it was tough anyway, city life for me was tough, but emotionally it was tough there, that I needed to have a different kind of environment to do the kind of art I wanted to do, which is in a sense a little bit over there, you know? And but I think that what I learned and what I hope to try to express was that you carry that around with you everywhere you go. It doesn't matter. And in fact, I think it gets stronger. The more work you do in your studio, no matter where that is, the stronger you become as an artist. And so you can be anywhere. And I think it's easier now. I think the art world and the way people think about it is global, much more global now. And your access to art and artists are all global now. You know, when I was a student, there were two experiences that I had with paintings. The first time I had saw a painting for real and not in reproduction, and one was a Pollock at MoMA, and the other were the Rothkos at the Tate in London. And for years after that, I could not remember what those paintings looked like exactly, but it was when I mentioned this encounter, it was how they moved me and what it meant to me, how it changed me. And that was what I carried around with me now. But now you can see those, you can just go online and you can actually see those paintings. You have access to those things. And I think that that's actually more helpful because it brings those things to you all the time, you know? So I don't know if that answered your question.
There is a vague
question. Yeah, well, and a vague answer for it, yeah. Yes.
Yeah, hands out.
Yeah, you all seem to have a strong sense of the history, and whether it's the history of the objects you're working with, or general art history, or your own personal history, and that's something that I've tried to express to students about the importance of looking at the past and what's come before. And I was just wondering if you could speak to that a little bit. In terms of what it's meant to you, all the artists that have come before?
That's probably a great question for Varujan.
But I didn't quite hear it.
The question is the importance of art history to you and stressing that.
Very important. Art history is very important. And I'm always looking at art books. I don't have access to museums in this area except the Hood. And once in a while, a show at Ava. So we rely on books. And I love art history. And I used to enjoy going to art history lectures and seeing the slides and taking a little nap in the warmness of the auditorium. Listening to the marvelous fiction that art historians would come up with regarding the work on the screen. Mm-hmm. And it was so imaginative. And I think it's great. I love to sit on art history lectures. But look, it's wonder when you think, mention the name Picasso, mention the name Vuillard, mention Pito, all these images, if you are acquainted with them. And how do you get acquainted with them? But through art history, right? Mm-hmm. And it enriches us and makes us, you know, yeah, I mean, to me it's very important. Mm-hmm. But please go to art history lectures. They're really great. Yeah.
I'm assuming you feel the same way, Jim.
I do. Yes. Well, I think there's a all of the work which has been done in the past, I don't want to separate myself from it. I don't want to throw it over. I don't want to make something which annihilates what has been done in the past. I want to be part of that conversation. And I mean, there's been a lot of talk for several decades now about the death of painting. And I don't think, as long as that stuff is there and around and hanging on walls, you have to pay attention to the idea that making colored marks on a surface can be a profound event. You might not be the champion of that, but you're participating in that conversation, and that sense of community is important.
Terrific. Do you want to take the question, or should we take one more?
Take five more.
That's a question.
Yeah. I'm sitting here, and I'm very struck by a sense of privilege in the kinds of places for your art making that are being described. So one has a studio, and one can go to that studio and choose to leave it, remain in it, choose to invite people into it, or not to, choose to make coffee, or not to. And I myself am writing a book about soldier culture at the front in World War I. And I'm thinking about place as something that is so totally different that I want to raise that issue in front of you and say, what about places of imposed madness or incredible privation, of deep despair and of horror beyond belief, and art that is taking place in those places as well?
Who wants to take that question?
Rebecca.
I want to say thank you. Yeah. I'm totally aware of the privilege that I have, and it was hard won too. It's certainly not what you're talking about, but the world is a complicated and big and a place that's full of all kinds of experiences, and I think it's important to recognize those experiences that you're talking about, that you're writing about, and I would look forward to you know, talking to you about that or experiencing that. I don't think that that's invalidates the nature of painting, or in my case, abstract painting. I think it has a place. It's not it's a unique one, and one that's sort of apart, but I think it's valid too, and I think we all need that as well. I'm not tied to the studio. You know, I'm not there all the time. I do travel, and I do read, and do look, so we're not unaware, but I think we need to embrace all those aspects of our life that are as people on this planet, so, yeah. But thank you.
I'm paraphrasing again a statement that I heard by the poet John Ashbery. He said, "I believe very much in the need for involvement with public events. I also believe very much in the art of poetry. And I don't think that the two have anything to do with each other."
All right. I think we have learned a great deal from this panel discussion. Thank you for coming. Thank you for your questions. We're going to go upstairs now for a reception and a special surprise for Varujan's birthday. Thank you very much.